Afternoon. My name's Lisa. I'm 28. I work and I'm unmarried. My sister's 30. She's never worked a day in her life. She's a single parent of 5 children. If you take into account children benefit, housing benefit, free school meals, clothing allowances for interviews she very rarely goes to, council tax allowances, water allowances, everything else, we sat and worked it out, and her average income is around about £40,000 to £45,000 a year, if you then add the 30% tax on. My question is two-part. A, why would people work? And B, how can you justify a welfare state where people get handouts of more than the allowance that is allowable for working people to claim benefits?
Mm. Well, I think this is a huge, huge issue. And let me tell you what we're doing about it, right? First thing we're doing, which lots of people object to, I've got to be very honest with you, it's a very, very controversial issue in my own party. Lots of people don't like that we're doing this in government, but I think it's the right thing to do. We've said, look, there's got to be an upper limit to what you can get in total from benefits. It's got to be a generous upper limit, and I think it's set at, is it 26? Thousand.
Is that before or after tax, if you work out what the working person would pay on tax?
No, that would be after, so it would be...
So
26,000 plus whatever tax a working person would pay.
Yes, let me double-check on that. But you've got this upper limit on the overall... It's called the overall benefit cap, and then you've also got a cap on what you can receive in housing benefits. So we've put an upper limit on the overall number of benefits that you can receive and the... A total amount that you receive in housing benefit, just because housing benefit is a particularly sort of difficult area of the welfare system, which has ballooned in recent years. So that's one big step we're taking. It is controversial. It's the housing benefit cap in particular is very controversial, not so much here, but much more so, for instance, in parts of London, which are very high rental areas. And we're doing a lot of work at the moment to make sure that those who are affected by that cap know when it's coming in so that they can make different arrangements so that they're not sort of caught out by it. So that's the first thing. The second thing we're doing is changing the whole benefit system as of it's going to start next year. So all, and I think the way you described your sister is a classic example of this. She's receiving all these different benefits for all these different reasons. And as you say, it's removing her incentive to work or indeed even go to any of the interviews that you said for which she receives some support. What we're saying is all of those benefits need to be simplified into one entitlement called the universal credit, so that instead of having lots and lots and lots of different pots of money, you have one of them. And it'll be arranged in a way that in future your sister will get that block of money, the universal credit, but here's the big thing, at every single point it'll pay for her to work. Because at the moment, she and many, many other people in this country have no incentive to work, which it's not fair on the... all other taxpayers. It's not fair on her. It's not fair on, you know, dare I say it, on you or on the rest of her family or on society, because work is good. You know, I think people getting out and working and, you know, looking after themselves, looking after their family is something that everybody believes in. So we're going to simplify the benefits, universal credit, and it'll then be arranged, what they call technically tapered, in a way that it'll pay to work. And the third and final thing, something I'm particularly sort of passionate about, which I've been sort of kind of pushing through government, is we're going to make sure that when you work, you just keep more of your money. So at the moment, when we came into government a couple of years ago, you got, as you'll know, you started paying income tax the moment you earned 6,400 quid, right? As of next April, we've raised that by a whopping almost 3,000 quid to 9,205, to be precise. It'll be next April. And that'll mean that we will have taken, over the last 2.5 years, over 2 million people on low pay out of paying any income tax altogether. And it's worth about £560 for every basic rate taxpayer in this country, of which there are 23 million. And then we're going to go further, up to 10,000, so that you will keep all the money you earn up to £10,000. And so that interaction between the universal credit, which is simpler and clearer, so you know what you get, and that you keep more money if you, when you start working, even for a few hours, just means it'll transform the incentive for your sister and everybody else to actually work.
That's absolutely fantastic, but they're still going to earn £26,000 after tax for doing very little, because I should imagine the working system's going to be a minimum of 16 hours per week.
I think, by the way, I think it almost certainly is pre-tax, but never mind. It will nonetheless make a massive difference when you have universal credit. tapered in a way that it always pays for your sister to work, and she will know that she'll keep more of her money as she earns it because of the change in the tax system. Well, the frustration I totally share with you is we can't do this overnight, but I've discovered this a long time ago. You can't change everything overnight. But, for instance, the tax changes, moving the point at which you start paying income tax, is one of the biggest changes in the personal tax system in this country for years. So, in fact, this much maligned budget with, you know, all the kind of controversies around that, the biggest change in the budget, which I think has been somewhat obscured by pasties and all the rest of it, was a £3.5 billion benefit to 23 million pounds 23 million basic rate taxpayers by raising the point at which you pay income tax. I'd be really interested to know, actually,
that's
in a year
fantastic.
Or two, what difference it would make to your sister.
But from my perspective, that just seems a way to appease me by giving me slightly more money to appease me for the people around me who can always... The people who are on benefits, I can assure you, can always afford a bottle of wine and a packet of cigarettes.
Well, hang on. Wait. Hang on. Don't underestimate the significance of... firstly, look... The kind of my philosophy to the kind of a welfare state and benefits is that they should be generous and compassionate for people who've fallen on hard times, who are vulnerable and need help. But they shouldn't be, which is your point, a way of life. Yeah. And that was, by the way, the original conception of the welfare state from Beveridge and all those great people who created the welfare state. It wasn't there to kind of become a kind of permanent way of living. It was there to help people so they can get back into work. And I think what we're trying to do with these changes is return it, if you like, back to its original design, which is there to help people when they need help, but to constantly make sure that it always pays to work. It's not just for you, by the way. You know, having this cap on the overall amount you receive, having the cap on housing benefit, having this universal credit so that you're always going to be better off to work. Well, look, let's compare notes in a year or two's time. I think it'll make a big difference.